Hello, gang. I'm Jason Rohde. I am at Nomad Life in Montreal, and this is the fourth class of Canadian Culture Through Film for Champlain College. So I'm happy to see that most of you are here already, showed up a little early today. What we're going to be talking about today is, I called the class Our Home and Native Land. It's really about Indigenous films. So some of the films that have been made in Canada by the Indigenous people. Now, my initial plan for that included a lot more films from a greater variety of filmmakers, some Iroquois stories as well. But ultimately, I got so carried away in the fast runner, Atarnajuat, the fast runner that I figured we should just spend time looking at that film and that filmmaker as well. But before I do that, I want to talk to you a little bit about some of my own work, as I like to do, to always let you know a little about my own process, what I do, how I do it. And also, I'd like for us to spend some 20 minutes or so starting to brainstorm what your projects might be, your class project. So we're going to have a bit of a discussion before jumping into this truly epic film. So let's start with that. What I thought of showing you today that I've done is something I wanted to show you in the very first class, which is a kind of trailer that I put together for my Nomad Slow TV, which is playing behind us right now. Now, Nomad Slow TV has been a challenging project for me, but at the same time, it was years in the making, and it might be the one that I'm enjoying the most. So a little bit of backstory there. I started meditating about 2 years ago. I got interested in it. I've been interested in meditation for years, like ever since I was in high school, like. But I really started this practice of transcendental meditation a couple of years ago. And I love it. It's really great for me. It's something I encourage you all to try in your own way to meditate. And I wanted to find a way to bring people into that experience. I'd been working on this idea of slow TV for some time before that, but the way I saw it initially was really more like ambient videos. But when I really developed this meditation practice, this idea of transcendence was something I wanted to express through film. And how do you do that, right? How do you tell a story that's going to bring you or create images that are going to bring you into this hypnotic kind of state? And that's been Nomad Slow TV. So like I've mentioned before, it's live 24 hours a day. It's seasonal content. So every season I'm producing 12 hours of these this kind of meditation television or ambient videos to really always be in the moment. The idea that it's live is that there's no past, there's no future, there's only now. And as well, that's why the seasonal aspect is actually important, because although I figure that people could be watching this from all over the world, it's really, that's the personal link. This is the season, let's say, that I'm portraying. Now, the winter season is the toughest one for a multitude of reasons, but one of them is, the cold, you know, to film out in the cold. Just last night, the sunset was so beautiful up here, and I've always enjoyed the sight of, like, industrial settings, you know, like in just big buildings with chimneys and things like that. And one of those things is like oil refineries, right? So, you know, that's like pollution when you look at it, but I've always found it really beautiful. So last night I went out and I filmed this refinery near Montreal, And I was just out of the car for about 8 minutes, and my fingers, I still feel some pain, actually. Honestly, I might have hurt myself a little bit. So that's one of the elements that makes it more difficult, let's say, to shoot in the winter, but also the lack of color and the lack of obvious beauty. Like when you look up at trees, for example, when you see the leaves and so on and the light peeking through the leaves, that's an easy thing for your eye to find the beauty in. But when you're seeing something that's more scarce, like what's behind me, the lack of leaves, the diffused colors of winter. So honestly, the honest truth, this may be my favorite winter yet, just because my slow TV project has forced me to look at it in new eyes, and it's been really it's been a great winter so far. I find, like, is this the most beautiful winter yet, or is it just me? It's probably just me. So what I wanted to show you before coming back to our discussion on real Canadian culture and your projects and such, is this kind of trailer that I cut together in order for us to sell this as a channel on Samsung TVs, on, you know, like when you're going to Netflix or Disney Plus or Amazon or whatever your streaming service. It's really my kind of dream, you could say, is to see Nomad Slow TV there as an IP, as an intellectual property representing this meditation television. So here, this slow video that will give you an idea of the vibe that I'm going for with this.
Drift. Liberation. A happy wanderer journeying without purpose, traveling directed by intuition, not target. To move through places with no other objective than to experience the moment, detached from normal days, baggageless, going to places to find out what it's like. Slider, frictionless, skater, roller, perpetual motion, moving with ease. No end goal. An open book into which things fall. Gypsy. Roma. Nomad. Drift. Frictionless movement. Moving across a landscape, not in a straight line, an unpredictable endpoint, not traditional geometry. Is it even possible to predict the end point of a drift journey, a resting place of wind-driven snow, an object in motion by wind or water or land mass? Nirvana, heaven. Time is not the master, time made the servant, time is linear, perception. Movement changes the perception of time. Drift through time. Forever changed, forever altered.
I'm back and live here. I wanted to mention that the reason I love making this kind of content so much is that I do it completely freely. Much like that voiceover says, there's no script, there's no real destination. I don't know where it's gonna land. So all I really have to do is tune into the moment and let it guide me, really. I often say that I just follow beauty, but sometimes you seek it too in the strangest of things. So really it's just about intuition, right? And following that, that the moment.
The way.
Yeah, it's really wild for me to watch these kinds of trailers, these kinds of edits. There wasn't anything slow about that, obviously. But it's kind of like this idea of your life flashing before your eyes. And this movie life that I keep talking to you guys about, that I've trying to shape for myself, it reveals itself in these edits. You know, I'm watching them, and I'm sure I watch it so radically differently than anybody else, because I know every instant, I remember every moment, and they're all coming through so fast that it turns into this kind of dream, you know, like this, it's not real anymore. And when I say that, let me just pause this real quick. We were talking last week about documentary versus just about anything else, and what is real, and what makes something real or subjective as opposed to objective. I never saw myself as a documentary filmmaker. Like when I studied film, I didn't even like documentary films back then, really. Over 20 years ago already. Yet I ended up making documentaries. Now, why is that? It's because I was, all of my movies, everything I would film, even if I would film it with 16 millimeter film or just the right equipment, that sort of thing, no matter how I would go about it, whenever I'd look at the result, it didn't feel like a real movie. Like I couldn't quite put my finger on what it was that differentiated my work from just about anything else I was watching. Was it because I didn't have a star in my movie? You know, I'd enjoyed and admired films that didn't have anybody famous in them. So finally, there was a moment in one of my movies. It was the very last moment of the film. The movie it was a student film. It was called 1042. And it lasted 10 minutes and 42 seconds. And it's about this writer that's writing a script, writing an action movie. And in the moment where his nemesis in the story comes into the story, he actually comes into his apartment. And so the rest of the movie kind of unfolds in a way that he's regretting the movie that he's been making, because now the movie's coming after him. So it's not a movie that takes itself very seriously, but it might be one of my best. You know, it's a student film and all, but I watched it again about a year ago or so, and I thought, oh, it's not aging badly. But my point is, the very last moment of the movie, the two characters are looking, we filmed it on my rooftop in Brooklyn at the time, and the two actors are looking out at the sunset, and they say something like, don't worry about it, this is all a movie, you know, this is just going to be some happy ending. So there's this question about what is real and what is not. And then I just had a little bit more film left. So I said, okay, let's keep rolling. And the film is running out, and cut. And you hear me in the background as the director saying this, talking about what's going on in the camera, telling the actors about this. And when I say cut, then the camera cut and the light came in, because the film slowed down in the camera. So light, like this kind of flare, comes into to the screen. And you see at the same time the actors kind of break their character. And that moment, that whole scene, the dialogue, whatever it said about reality and the fact that we're watching a movie, and then to see the actors break out of the scene for just that split instant, literally it lasts less than a second, I thought, I got it. That's the first moment I managed to capture, I felt, that was real, that felt like a real movie. So that's when I put my finger on it. It was the authenticity of that moment that made it satisfactory to me as a filmmaker. I felt like I managed to portray what I wanted to. So since that day, I kept digging in there. I mentioned on the first class with my VJing and the fact that with improvising with cinema through the editing, live editing, and that sort of thing, that freed me in a way. But it was really starting to think about how can I capture moments of authenticity and then tell a story with that. So everything I film now, everything, like every movie, I'm never questioning whether is this a documentary or is it a work of fiction, or there's no real difference in my mind. I'm just trying to capture moments that I can then reshape through editing, and it's all fiction. That's the way I look at it. It's not all real, all documentary, no. It's all fiction, even my life, even what I'm taking on. And that's what you're gonna see as well in the film that we're gonna watch today in Fast Runner. The Fast Runner is the same kind of story that you saw in Nanook of the North. And we're seeing that same life, that still same culture expressed by someone who is an Inuk, you know, speaking their original language and so on. And as opposed to having a director from outside telling that kind of story, it's done from the inside. It's done by someone who knows that culture intrinsically. And it's wonderful for it. It's a work of fiction. It's not a documentary, but you're gonna see how the line is very thin once again, you know? So that's something that couldn't interest me more as a filmmaker, is this fine line between dreams and reality. So now let me turn it back to you for 10 minutes or so, 10, 15, before we get into the Fast Runner, because I'd like us to start thinking about what the project for the class should be. I'm very open about it, but I'm wondering, have any of you started thinking about that? Is that of what you might do, how you might do it, what shape it might take? And it could be really anything. It could be a short film. It could be a work of fiction. It could be a documentary piece. It could be a simple interview of someone that you wanted to speak to. It doesn't have to be long in that way. You know, you don't have to go in depth. It can be a short thing, because then you can, with the project, like, let's say you make a game, and that the game, I'm just going to say anything, that the game lasts, the whole gameplay lasts like a minute. So you can also present that and explain what you put into it, why you did what you did, and your whole thought process. So I don't know if you've noticed yet, but really what I'm interested in for you in this class is for you to develop a sort of critical thinking about your own culture, about what made you. And that's something that, well, not so consciously on my part, I wasn't thinking about my culture or something like that, but I've used my craft in order to get to know myself better. Like I mentioned with Voices of Freedom, I wanted to go and see for myself what the American people were up to. I couldn't relate anymore. I couldn't as well make the real connection between the American people I knew and what I was seeing through the media. So having myself this kind of critical thinking about media, I wanted to go further beyond the screen. So that's a kind of approach that I would like you to take. So I'd like to hear from one of you, at the very least, just an idea, something. It doesn't mean that should be what you would do, but what might be an idea for a project of the sort?
I'm not sure what shape the project is going to take, but something that always interests me is like what's left on the cutting room floor, what's left out of these documentaries that we don't see, whether it seem arbitrary to the filmmaker, but maybe important to the person watching.
Yeah, oh, that's very interesting for sure. It brings up an idea that I don't know if you've ever heard of this. I heard this in film school, I think. It's not what you show, it's what you don't show. Does that mean anything to anybody? It's not what you show, it's what you don't show?
Oh, yeah. I mean, the first example that I think of, just because it's very American, is war movies. How they'll show heroism and bravery, but they won't show the soldier left traumatized and homeless by a government that abandons them.
True. That is one way to approach it, for sure, to think about that idea. It's also, the way I like to see that, it's as much about framing. It's as much about scripting as framing as editing. So let's say I'm filming, what you talked about is scripting, is the story you choose to tell. So you might manage to say something more clearly by what you choose not to include. Same thing with the way you film something. You might choose a perspective, a specific framing, where you'll cut out the McDonald's sign. You know, like in my Voices of Freedom movie, you don't see any Walmart signs or any McDonald's signs on the side of the road or anything of the sort. Now, why is that? That's part of America, right? But in the way that I'm trying to portray this America or freedom in this context, it's really by excluding certain things that I end up telling the story I want to tell. Because if I start including everything that's available to me, it's less focused kind of communication. It's a less focused communication. Same thing with editing. Like, as you said, Alex, it's you can define your film by what you choose not to show, not to include, what you leave on the cutting room floor, as used to be the literal case not so long ago. And that reminds me of something as well. I mentioned about the earlier with 1042 at the end of the film, with the light coming into, like, these kinds of flares popping into the lens, right, onto the film, and how I like that. Now we fake that stuff, you know, we like put it on top after of the image. But with film, it's something that happens very naturally every time you start recording, and when you stop recording, the film speeds up and slows down. So that creates a kind of effect. It was one of my first exercises in school. One of my first real movies in school. It was called The Hurt. It was on the song by Nine Inch Nails, Hurt. And I liked that aesthetic so much, that look, that all that stuff that would end up on the cutting room floor, I would end up picking back up and stitching together, you know, and sometimes it'd be two frames, one frame, three frames, all one after the other, you know, and really just all the I'm going to cut in some of those examples to really express what I mean, but it was basically what turned up on the cutting room floor that I felt, again, was the most authentic. And it made its way back into the film in kind of flashback kind of sequence. So that's a very interesting idea, Alex, indeed. What you don't show. You might want to look up that kind of quote. I'm sure there's been things written about that. I've heard Martin Scorsese discuss that. It's not what you show, it's what you don't show. And I've asked my my daughters, my oldest is 12. I've asked them, I've been teaching them how to make movies in my own way for years already. I've been filming them forever. And I mentioned these sorts of things, you know, and I'm asking, what does that mean to you? It doesn't mean anything. So I'm hoping it means a little more to you today than it does my own kids. So that's a great example, Alex. That's a good through line, and there's different ways of exploring that. And I would encourage you to talk to me about that again. You know, we're going to have the chance to do a kind of pre-presentation of what we want to do, and then to criticize that before you actually go ahead and do it. So it could be an essay, could be a short story. What I like this is personal. It might not be for all of you, but what I like to see is something personal, something that really only comes from you. I don't need something didactic explaining to me, the showing me that you understand something. If you're going to be showing me that you understand something by internalizing it. And frankly, I don't care if it has anything to do with Canadian culture, really. I'm sure this whole discussion on culture, the fact that I'm Canadian and some of you are only half, but most of you are not Canadian at all, it's just going to help you give you that perspective towards yourself. Anybody else have some themes that they're thinking of exploring? Or
I was going to say, something that you just brought up that I thought was interesting was kind of that the idea of like two cultures, and like it doesn't have to necessarily be about Canadian culture, but I am half Canadian, and so I've grown up with that culture from my dad's side, and when we visited, it was always an interesting experience, because it wasn't like the people I was meeting in my family that didn't speak English and I couldn't understand them. It was just like they had a different way of doing things, they just had different customs, different ways of kind of tradition, bring family together. I grew up with like family, like, you know, being around the table for dinner, that was about it. But like with my dad's family, it's like everyone, like all the families in one little area, like one street, it's all coming together and having these big dinners, and it's always like this lively thing. And so I think it's kind of interesting just to see the dynamic between the two and what we value, I guess, between the two cultures.
Oh yeah, that is that's a very good through line as well, Donovan. Yeah, this, my father is Italian, and I identify with the Italian culture very much, you know, and it makes me a different kind of Canadian. The fact that my father is Italian, and that's certainly something that's worth exploring, you know. Why do I want you to explore that, like to make it a little more personal? It's because that's where the real learning comes, right? It's, you're probably going to forget most of what we go through in class, the name of that movie or something, except for a few things. But really the growing that you're able to do through our time together, and we've already spent almost a quarter of it, of the whole class, it goes by fast. That's really what's going to stick. So if Donovan, for example, if you choose to explore this dichotomy inside yourself, I'm sure you're going to come out of it knowing yourself a little better, and you're going to come out of it grown. So that's why I think that's it's really worthwhile in the class to take that approach. So one more person, and I would very much like to hear from someone we've yet to hear from, because I know Alex and Donovan are always quick to volunteer, and I greatly appreciate that, but I don't want to, let's see, Sophia. Yes. I've been enjoying Sophia's, I've been enjoying your blog posts a lot, so I'd be curious to hear what's on your mind.
I was thinking for my project, like, I guess it's not very cultural, I suppose, but like, I've been interested in like the variations of human life and like how we all live, and I would like to be able to show like a bunch of different like daily lives, I guess, like during quarantine, and seeing how they all vary or how they don't vary, just seeing how we all like try to work during this situation.
Yeah, I'm sure you'll find it's always nice to surprise yourself, right? So you go out towards something and you have an idea of what you're going to be saying or what you're going to be exploring. But I think that with an idea like that or a theme like that, you're gonna be surprised by some of the things you find. That could be a very good thing. That's a good one, Sophia. Yeah, it's tough, right? With the quarantine, and life is so different, and we're all insulated, you know? We're all segregated in our own little bubbles. And that would be a good way for you to explore some other bubbles out there. I was just contacted yesterday for some of my images on my Slow TV for a project they're doing up here about more Montreal in quarantine, you know? And So they wanted some of my kind of drone images of Montreal and under the snow. And so I know that a lot of people are exploring that. You know, something I was thinking about very early on in the pandemic is that, you know, I'm always thinking about movies. You have screenwriters that are writing the movies of 2-3 years from now. If the movie gets made really quickly, if you're writing a script today, and like you're part of the studio system, you're doing it for hire or something like that, and you manage to get your movie done in like 2-3 years, it's extremely rare. But let's use that as an example. You're writing a script from quarantine, and your movie's going to be coming out in 3 years from now. Nobody knows what the world will look like 2-3 years from now. You know, are we still going to be wearing masks? How are all of our mores and behaviors going to have been affected, changed? Will people still shake hands? Are we going to go back to that? Are we never going to go back to that? Or something with masks and everything else, events and so on. Like, are we, when the pandemic's going to be done, I don't know if it's ever going to be completely done, but once really we're out of the pandemic stage, I doubt we're going to go back into large stadiums gathering like 50,000 people tightly knit together. We might, but yeah, that's a question I asked myself. I put myself in the shoes of those screenwriters writing the stories of tomorrow. You know, systematically, that's what you're doing. You're not in the now. And not knowing what that world will look like. So it's, there's something in that as well. Okay, I'm tempted to ask one more person, but we should really start. That's my dad calling. He might do that 3-4 more times today, as he tends to. So the movie I'm gonna show you now is, like I said, it's The Slow Runner. It's the original film is it's about 3 hours long, so of course I had to cut it down a great deal, but I couldn't cut it down the way I did with Nanook. You know, with Nanook of the North, I cut like every text on the screen. I cut to a third. A lot of the scenes, they go on 2, 3, 4 times longer than what I ended up with to show you. But in this case, I really couldn't do that because I'd be kind of taking away the whole point of showing you this, which is pacing. So I cut out a lot of scenes, I kept just enough for you to get the gist of the story and everything. But still, I want you to dive in there and experience this kind of pacing for yourself and this kind of storytelling for yourself. And then I'll cut in sometimes and let you know a bit about the film. So I'm gonna be quiet now and enjoy The Fast Runner.
Thank you.
So Atanarjuat, the fast runner, was made in 2001. And it truly is an epic film, as you're going to find. It's unlike anything else because it's the first film directed by an Inuit filmmaker. And everybody involved is Inuit. I think like the cinematographer might not be. His name is Nicholas Cohn, I think. But otherwise, that's it. Everybody, all the actors, even the language they are speaking is the original language that they still speak to this day, but that is used so much less than it used to not so long ago. It was produced by his company. The name of the director is Zacharias Kunuk. Zacharias Kunuk, and his company is called Isuma Iglulik Productions, and Iglulik is the name of a town where he grew up and where this film was done. So whoever gets the necklace ends up being the leader of the tribe. So the Inuit people are actually one of the oldest people that we know of, you know, that we can trace the culture back as far as 5,000 years. And that's something I can't kind of visualize for myself, honestly, but this culture, you know, this way of living is something that's been passed on and on and on from one generation to the next, and you can think that 1,000 years ago might have been a very similar life than that of 100 years ago or 2,000 years ago. So what they're portraying here in this film is something that might have happened about 1,000 years ago. And it's a story that's been passed on from generation to generation through written word. in this language. And so this makes, I think I mentioned this before, but this makes it the first feature film ever to be written, directed, and acted entirely in the Inuktitut language. I look at these scenes and I think of Nanook of the North, and I ask myself how much more of a documentary is Nanook compared to this? Where Nanook, they were staging, you know, they changed the names of some of the characters, or some of the people, to make them more memorable. And then they staged events as well. And I guess the main difference here is that the people making the film, they were riding around on snowmobiles and stuff, and that's how the way of life that they're portraying is gone. But at the same time, I feel like they're really capturing something that is fleeting, is going to be gone soon, but it's still there then. It's just like the last kind of remnants of that culture that they're able, you know, everything, the way the costumes, of course, are not costumes. They're really made the way that these people have been making them for thousands of years. So it's not a documentary in no way, but again, this fine line between capturing reality and what a documentary might be is very, very thin. Something worth mentioning here again is the it's like all of these movements in filmmaking that we've been looking at, from this very first documentary ever made, that is Nanook of the North, to, you know, everything, even the one by François Girard that we saw, Land of Souls there. You know, it's always the technology that's allowing us to tell these new stories in new ways. This is a very old story that couldn't have been told before 2001. Mostly because, as beautiful as the cinematography is, it's still, you can tell from the aesthetic that it wasn't shot on film. This is shot on the best video available at the time. And when I saw it back in the day, when it came out, I actually went to see this film in the theater. And I didn't even really think about the fact that it was in video. I actually thought it was shot on film until I saw it again recently, and was surprised to see that in a way, because I remembered it being so very beautiful. So in the Nook of the North, they couldn't really film inside an igloo. They faked that. But in because they couldn't get the camera far enough, they couldn't really, not get the camera far enough, but they couldn't light inside of the igloos. They didn't have the space to do it. Whereas in this film, they're able to bring the camera into a real igloo, bring some lights in, sometimes even shoot without lights, you know, just shoot under the firelight. I think the previous scene was shot only with the fire. So that's always important to keep in mind, how the technology is allowing us to tell these stories in new ways. And that's something that interests me as well, is what new technologies, what new ways are available to me. The way I think about it is more like, what's available to me? How can I make the most of what is available to me now as a filmmaker? And one of those, you know, that's why I explored live streaming and how to tell stories with live streaming and that sort of thing, or same thing with projections, with Moment Factory, and, you know, before the digital age, even with projectors, that opened up this whole new way of showing films, and that affected the movies we choose to make or the video that we choose to make. So that's also something for you to keep in mind with your own project. I'd be very glad for you to use some things that are very new, you know, like a way of interacting with the audience, perhaps, or even making something with your phone, or who knows, you know, I've included shots in my films that were filmed with my phone and nobody noticed it. So it just goes to show, but it's interesting, you can get the phone in places that you can't get an actual camera, right? I can put the phone like on my dashboard in my car, but I can't do that with like my DSLR, for example, you know. So it's these new technologies are permitting me to put the camera in places I couldn't before. Like my first real movie, and you could say my first real movie, is the one where I climb Mount Everest, and could I have made that film without a DV, you know, a digital video? I guess they would call it DV cameras, with these little tapes and everything, and the batteries that could last long enough, and the camera that could resist the cold. You know, all these elements made it possible for me to tell that story in that way, and I'm sure that it would have been a very, very different movie, a different story even, had I had to shoot it on film, or maybe I wouldn't even made the movie. So these are, this is another way for you to think about your own project. How you could use the tools of the day to tell a story in a new way, or like an old story in a new way, or a story in a new way, or a new kind of story altogether. So I cut forward there. I might have cut like 20 minutes out of the movie right there, just to jump to this scene. So just to give you a kind of idea, you know, it's easier to, if you know what the film is about, to follow the story. It's, you know, it revolves around Atarnajuat, this guy. No, I'm sorry. Those are the brothers. He's the one holding the snow. That's the main character, and he gets married with two wives. You know, he ends up with two wives, and I think they're sisters, if I remember correctly. The two wives. Anyway, he ends up, you know, with the animosity of the band leader, of the tribe leader there, who was promised that wife. And so he ends up killing Atarnajuat's brother, and forces Atarnajuat to flee by foot. And he's famously a fast runner. I just cut part of the film out again here. He runs away by foot, but he's always known as a fast runner throughout the whole film. But you'll see that scene is just it's going to be one of the most incredible things you've ever seen on film, I think. Dween, Lungun, Ayun, Lapa, Pasuya, Natich, Kissim, Mamangit, Kissim, Kasuya, Kihal, Ekiana, Sapam, Tiria, Kuluglit, Kanoe, Lilugulit, Pilau, Milagulit, Hangi, Hangi, Saram, Pisut, Saram, Damam, Kasunis, Katipat, Yasunis, Katipat, Nak, Kak, Saram, Pisut, Saram, Damam, Kasunis, Katipat.
Yeah. Oi, don't all do the other one in man. I can't do the other one in man. Yang utang masih nanang minimal di lok tengah.
I hope you can see why. I'm just going to cut in here to remind you that I'm still with you. So you can see why I felt I couldn't cut these scenes short. Because there's something about their entire pacing, the whole way that the scene unfolds, how it takes its time, those pauses in between things, that the entirety of a ritual, some of which I cut short later on, but that I really felt would, if I was to start cutting these scenes shorter, you weren't even gonna understand really what makes this film so different. Well, it's not just that it's slower, but it has its own pace. It's like the culture of this people comes across in everything. Not just the obvious things in their behavior, but in their actual pacing. How they'll take a moment to think about something, for someone to react, and I think that must have been so true to this place and time.
Amma, how you need a tinu kaitikito?
Kurima! Atanarjuat tikito!
I don't know if you recall, in Nanook of the North, there was a scene where he accosts his boat, very similar boat, in very much the same way along the bank on the side.
Pereka terima muka kanga kau yup. Tisik tisu tisu makatain nako yuk luaro.
Siapa em? Betul maksa kerenan.
Now in Nanook of the North, there was a walrus that they dragged off the bank there. Here it's a seal that he brought on the boat. But I like all these similarities between Nanook of the North and this film, which is why I felt compelled to just take our time and look at this movie. That I just cut a bunch of the movie out here again. I always feel bad for doing that, but the quick thing I should mention is that this movie won the Caméra d'Or at the Cannes Film Festival. That's like the Golden Camera, which I think is given, if I'm not mistaken, it's given to for the best first feature film from a director. And so it really had an immense success. It made some $5 million US at the box office. It was the Canadian film that made the most money that year. Very unlikely story, because it's usually, you know, every film in Canada is made in English or French, and Telefilm Canada finances these pictures. SADC also puts up some money. These federally funded films. And I believe that the filmmakers really had to fight in order to have their film be in their own language, in the Inuktitut language. And thank God they did, because you can see from the success of the film, it's considered by some possibly the best Canadian film, and one could argue that it is for a variety of reasons, you know. In 2015 at TIFF, at the Toronto International Film Festival, this film was voted by filmmakers as the best Canadian film of all time.
I'm not sure what I'm doing.
So beyond that scene, that entire sequence is one that I really wanted to keep intact, because not just because of the pacing, but the whole kind of behavior of these two lovers, the way they flirt on the beach, warming of the hands at various moments as an excuse to touch each other, to get warm. The singing as well. So all these little kind of love rituals. This is important. I skipped ahead a bit. In the film here, And this is when, so he has both wives, and this is when one of them ends up cheating on him with his brother, that same one that he just made love to. I just felt that whole scene was very, the whole sequence of these two lovers coming together was so authentic that it was worth keeping in the film. Even though the sex scene, I guess, I considered cutting out for the purposes of the class, but again, for the sake of authenticity, I really feel like they went for it. It's all so real, isn't it? The way that even the children are included in the scenes, the way the scenes play out, you gotta wonder, are they improvised, or how scripted is it? How much are they letting things play out? The wisdom of these actors, who are not very experienced, is really astounding to me. I've worked with all kinds of actors, you know, professional actors and non-professional actors, and the quality of the craft in this film, the way that they all let the scenes play out, it can only be proof of a truly great director behind the camera to guide this along. Now, there's a kind of subtle subplot it's central to the story, really, but it's because I've cut so much of the film out, I'm not sure how much this aspect is coming across. So I'm gonna mention this here, because there's a spirit, an evil spirit, that's come into the life of this people. I don't know if you remember, but during the fight scene, when one of them gets hit on the side of the head, he has this kind of vision, you know? So that's the evil spirit that's among them. And the way they visualize that is through some dreams, and they speak about it as well. It's mostly the... You remember there was that one moment where the elderly woman called upon her dead husband to come help get rid of the spirit. So much of the story is about getting rid of this bad spirit. But because it's so this myth is so integrated into their way of life, they don't speak about it I guess, clearly. You kind of have to decipher this, and it really comes across way better if you don't cut any of the film out in simple lines and stuff like that. But yeah, hopefully I'm giving this film justice. I hope you're going to be paying attention for the next 10-15 minutes, as this is truly an incredible scene. So that's Atarnajuat's brother that's been killed. And so Pooja, one of the two wives, the kind of promiscuous one, ran away to the other tribe to let them know that, Atarnajuat tried to kill her. So they decide to go and kill the two brothers. And that's what brings Atarnajuat to do his infamous fast run. See, that's the two wives. That's one of the two wives.
Maura! Maura!
The film was made in the month of April because it's actually a very short window where it's just warm enough that the cameras won't freeze up. So, you know, I mentioned earlier that Telefilm Canada will finance these films, but this film was not financed by Telefilm Canada. The main reason might have been because of the language, but the National Film Board, the NFB, or ONF in French, Office National du Film, are the ones that ended up financing the film. And it cost nearly $2 million to make, which is a lot of money in a way, but it made it back healthily at $5 million. And as I mentioned in an earlier class, it's actually quite rare that Canadian films make their money back.
Dako, nagayugi na karoktutid na ka.
Ugh.
Kinawi. At an Ardang of Angayuga Amarza in Wakta Sart.
Can I near the balloon?
Kikuni Piana should come with Sarro Ilaminin. Okio Sarro Nat. Kayamagavigi. Ilagigavigi. Allez, allez, tu veux dire que tu mets quoi? Tu mets assez vite aussi, ma vie. Dans les gens, tu te prends les calories avec ça. Quand on regarde, il y a des gens là.
Adlari, Inari, Kikori Niko. Oh, you can never look. You want to come again? You just see the city at night. What do you put out of?
Apparently, a lot of the crew and the actors and so on had heard this story as children. Like, this is a story that was part already of their vernacular, their worldview, let's say. And so I can understand how they took it upon themselves to really tell that story. They made very few changes, except a major change to the original story, which is which comes near the end, where the original story ends in a bloodbath of sorts, where everyone ends up. It's kind of a revenge story almost. This one chooses another route, and it was done so purposefully in order to change with the times and perhaps evolve as a people, and so. Historical accuracy is extremely important throughout the film, but at the same time, there's for the writers, there's they're conscious that they're part of a new time and that they have some growing to do themselves. So yeah, like the battle scene and that sort of thing, and the whole dynamic between men and women. We look at this now, and it seems archaic, of course, and I'm sure that. They've grown beyond this, but some details meant more to them that they be upgraded in a way. This important detail about the very ending of the film. I'd like to read you something that. One of the writers said, his name is Paul Apak Agilirk, and this is about using the Anuktitut language. So he said, we go to the elders and ask information about the old ways, about religion, about things that a lot of people have no remembrance of now. They are helping us write down what people would have said and acted in the past, and what the dialogue would have been like. We speak baby talk compared to the elders. But for Atarnajuat, we want people speaking real Inuktitut. When we are writing the script, they might jump in and say, oh, we wouldn't say such a word to our in-law. We wouldn't say anything to our brother's wives. It was against the law. And something else I wanted to read to you here is from Kunuk, the director of the film. He's a real visionary, in case you didn't notice yet. And this is about production. So he says, everything was different. The way we traveled, the way we camped, It was just like when we go out today, spring camping, putting up canvas tents and moving from here to there. We would go 50 miles out into the country where there are no roads, nothing. Like the land was from the time it was created. There would be 15 tents and 80 people, all the kids running around just waiting for a perfect day. When we had a perfect day, the actors put on their makeup and costumes and we went out onto the site where we wanted to shoot. You see, there was mention of that evil spirit again. So that's throughout. And what does that mean, an evil spirit? Is it like in the literal sense, or I might get a little spiritual on you and start giving you some of my own worldview, the way I see the world. But I personally, I believe in everything. I think there is truth in absolutely everything, in every religion, it's all just different ways of looking at the same thing. And so the way I see them talk about this spirit, this evil spirit, like that's behind him, for example, the way he just said now, or that he's afraid that that spirit might get him. And they might be talking simply about this sort of, this anger, let's say, this thing that might come over you that you can't control, you know, like as if it comes from outside. And I'm sure most of you have experienced emotions in this way, you know, especially in the case of anger, where it seems like it might come from outside. And when you're able to center yourself again, you can exorcise the evil within you, your evil spirit. And I believe, and at least that's how I'm understanding the way that they speak about the evil spirit in the film, and how he wouldn't want it to take over him, you know. There's a kind of wisdom that Atarnajuat, he's not a perfect man, not a perfect character, but he's trying to rise above that. Yeah, I see it all as true. It's not like just a fairy tale. This actually happened, not exactly in this way, but there is truth to the way they speak about this that holds true to this day, in my humble opinion. That's what you'll see as well with the ending of the film, is that again they're trying to exorcise that spirit themselves, you could say, by changing the ending into something that reflects not just the times but how they've grown as a people. This is a scene that it's not so consequential to the story, so I thought about cutting it out, but I kept it because of the detail with the oil there, which looks so authentic, but especially because of the acting of the young woman, I just thought was remarkable.
Han jang et hjertet mig. Og der er næste med øvrigt, at der kommer efter nærmig, at det går i mig. Ani, ikayok tao yaka yakara kata, akaw ngiti may tuwaro na kata. Tikit ta kaya kara kami, ani. Ikayok tao yaka yakara kata, ani. Ani. Ani.
Iling ni, ang ikaw ko tao yaka yakang nara kata. Pituin na kaya kara kawit. Ang ikaw ko tao na sumunyalo po. Uva. Pilo. Pituin na anak si Matelak tingwa. Pag natuin na kaya katelak tingwa.
I cut out a big part of the film there. What happens is he has this rabbit's foot, and he shakes it about in the wind, and he ends up finding his direction home, I guess. And then the brother finds that he's able to catch a rabbit by hand, and he eats it right there and then raw. And he gets sick. And you could say that this kind of helped him exorcise the evil spirit. Now, I gotta admit this kind of went over my head, which is why I didn't include it, but it's not to say it wasn't important to the story, so I thought I should at least mention it. So now we have Atarnajuat returning home after the older brother, well, I'm not explaining it well, but basically they spoke through the flame, I guess, from one sister to her brother. You see how he's been exorcised of his evil in a way? Yeah, I love how you wait for them to come all the way across, just to give a sense of the space.
I'm going to go to the house.
Do I need to mention how Nanook would lick his knife as well? Remember that? With his white tongue licking his knife to make it cut better. And there was also in Picture of Light, I don't know if you remember, but this man who ended up with frostbite, who's lost his toes, he had lost his ice knife. And to them, that's like, it's life or death, whether they have this or not. So Atarnajuat made his new igloo, his new home, and with this ice floor. Now I'm not sure why usually they make those ice floors, but it's important to the story here. So this was the difference Whereas in the original story that'd been told for hundreds, if not a couple of thousand years, at the end, Atarnajuat kills his tribesmen. And in this story, I love that line, the killing stops here. And it's almost like the Inuit people saying that. I find that to make this important change to the story, despite its everything else being so genuine, the film really doesn't just transport you to another world. It transports you to another. It creates its own sense of time and space. You know, time is different in this film, the way things play out. The space as well. I love the distances and how it all starts to mean something different for than it would in another film or in another story. Yeah, symbolism as well. The way symbolism is used is very much at the surface. It's almost like working on the level of symbolism before the level of actuality. I don't know if I'm expressing myself correctly when I say that, but that when we speak of the spirits and things like that, it's like we're expected to just understand. And that's great. That's what helps us be transported. Now, the film having been made mostly for Inuit audiences so that they could see like positive and accurate images of themselves portrayed on film, this very idea justifies even more this change of the ending, you know, because if they're looking at this as something to, I don't want to say aspire to, but as a reflection of themselves as a people, then I guess it would be important to change that ending. I want to read you another quote here from the director, who says, here it is, 4,000 years of oral history silenced by 50 years of priests, schools, and cable TV. I first heard the story of Atarnajuat from my mother. Kids all over Nunavut are playing Atarnajuat in the streets. So this idea that it was silenced and this, well, not so much, this story was silenced, but all of their stories, their culture was silenced in a way by religion. I have another interesting quote here from Norman Cohn. Remember I mentioned him as Nicholas Cohn earlier, as the cinematographer? He was also the producer in the film. His name is Norman Cohn. And he said in a 2002 interview that at one point the production company was considering making Atarnajuat action figures. I think you can understand why this is considered an epic film. It's epic in every way. The story is epic, the landscapes are epic, the characters have immense depth. It's really a remarkable movie. I'm very happy I could share it with you. Okay, so we were just at the end of Atarnajuat. Quite a special movie, I think you'll agree. Now, I just wanted to show you a little interview with the filmmaker
and the actor. Joining me on the filmmakers are Atanarjuat's director, Zacharias Kunuk, and its star, Natar Ungalak. Welcome, both of you. Thank you for being here. The legacy of this movie, unlike a lot of movies, the legacy just keeps growing and growing and growing, I feel. It's been pretty extraordinary. People have learned from it. People regard it as one of the best, if not the best, Canadian film of all time, which is pretty amazing. How does that feel to you?
I don't know. It hasn't settled into me yet, but that's our goal. I mean, that's the goal we're trying to achieve. All of us filmmakers, we're no different. We're the same.
Well, that's probably our one of the best story in our region, which we put it on the film. Mm-hmm. And it makes me very proud that we can pass our story from through tongue, then through films, mm-hmm. which is very good for us to be involved.
Tell me a little bit about the funding. Were there hurdles? Did you have to convince people that this was a valid story?
20 years ago, it was almost impossible to make a film if you're Aboriginal. And that's what we ran into. We never knew that this exists. That if you had a bright idea, anybody could propose for funding, get funding, and do it. In that time, it was not like that, probably for a long time. And we changed that. They also want our actors to speak English. And I had a good argument with that because I've seen kung fu movies. And I thought, maybe that's what it's going to look like, a kung fu movie. And I didn't want that.
How did you two find each other? How did you find your Atanarjuat?
It was accident. I know, Natar and I, we grew up together. We went to school together. We carved madly soapstone to make money when we were teenagers.
There's a famous scene, of course, where you have to run naked over the snow, barefoot. Talk to me about that scene.
Well, in my mind, nobody wanted to get that role naked in front of camera.
Right.
And I said to myself, if I have a chance, I'll play that role. I think that's the point that I pitch in perfectly to be in, as an Atanarjuat fast runner.
But well, you knew it was coming.
Yes. Because it was already there, so.
Right. So when you signed on, you were like, okay, that scene will happen. That's going to come.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. So how do you prepare yourself?
Well, everything has to be prepared from scratch. Behind the scene, I remember I was inside the tent, naked, trying to be warm, and little stove was on. And at the same time, before the break, I was making a coffee that built up, and the steam went up, and all of a sudden it spilled into my back, and I had little souvenir for that.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
And what about your feet?
Nothing cut.
Yeah.
But the only part that I had a little bit of cut was on my knee, because I had to fall down, and that was pretty interesting, challenging for me to be involved. And we planned it, takes and takes. It went so good.
This film won the Camera d'Or in Cannes. It was the first Canadian film to do that. What was that like?
It was, I thought it was normal. I mean, I thought every Canadian came to Cannes and won something. And I'm just part of the flow.
Wow.
That's what I thought.
And what was that experience like for you?
I had a good experience call from SAC, from Cannes to Iglutic. I was in the office and he ended up calling me, "We won." And I said, "What are we trying to win?" And all of a sudden, SAC said, "We won the film in Cannes." Oh, okay. I wasn't really that focused for trying to win and all that. And he made it happen.
It feels like there must be something a sort of before this film and after this film. Kids today that you're teaching grow up thinking this is normal. Of course there's a great, big, huge, award-winning film about our culture. What is that like for the two of you?
For me, it's great because when I came to Iglik in the 60s, I went to our little community hall where they watch movies, cowboys and Indians, and I thought it was God sent. Never knew there were cameras here and there, and so many people worked behind the camera. I mean, didn't even know that.
And are young filmmakers today, are they savvy? Do they watch YouTube and they figure it out? Are they teaching you stuff? Do you know stuff you're passing on to them?
Everybody has a style. They don't find their style. Want to be a filmmaker, it's a commitment that you have to take. It's like carving a stone.
How so?
It's like the carving you're working on, the stone you're wearing, it's going to tell a story. And when you put it on somebody's shelf, somebody's living room, it's going to be there. It's going to speak for itself.
You do a lot of stuff for education and keeping traditions alive, teaching people about their past. How does this film fit into that legacy? How is it part of what you do in your daily life?
It blends it very well because we come from oral history. The camera is exactly the perfect tool for this. It is.
Because it can just capture?
You just talk to. You just talk. You just act, you just, because that's what we learned when we were children. We're watching our father tie up the sled, how he ties it, how he harnessed the dogs, and we're trying it out ourselves.
Yeah, I grew up to that world, so I want that, preserve.
What do you do on your day off?
Day off? What day off?
He doesn't have a day off. I've been working with him. We don't really have day off. We don't have vacation.
And this winter, we're trying to film walrus hunting in the wintertime. And we never shot this. Never shot this. And we're trying. We almost drowned my skidoo.
Yeah.
I just started sinking, but he was driving, and I'm on the sled being pulled because I'm with all the camera equipment. And this skidoo started
sinking,
carving through the ice.
Yeah.
Wow.
And I'm going through that. And then he speeded up his throttle and got up.
So this would be the first time people would have put walrus hunting on film. Did you get a walrus?
No.
No?
No.
So what do you want people in the South to know about your film? You talk about, you know, getting circumpolar culture out to the world. What do you want people to know that they don't know about your culture?
I think the best part is to carry our style of clothing and our dialect that we carry on to this film. That was very important to me to
preserve that.
Preserve that as Atanap, as the fast runner.
Yeah.
We're part of this world. We're part of Canada. That's all. And it's a big country, just up there. That's what we do up there.
Yeah. Well, we're so glad that you were here to talk about it with us today. Thank you so much.
I just love it. I'm so happy that we got to watch this together. And I was glad to find this interview as well, and to show you what these people look like in real life. This is a more recent film. We're not going to watch the whole thing. I cut it much, much shorter. And just to give you an idea, it's not by the same director. The director is called Benoit Pilon. He's French-Canadian. He's not Inuit. But I felt it was kind of good to follow up with this because it's the same actor. And this is happening at a much later time, I believe, something like in the 50s. And it's about tuberculosis reaching this people. So this sickness that took over much of the world eventually reached the Inuit people as well. And in order to cure some of them, they would put them on boats and lead them into civilization to try to cure some of them. And so it's about the culture clash.
TV, prenez ma gavi. Umiar mitar yarar tuti, prendona nunanganu. Inuli sartar nyaravi. Nuliad paniktilu nunamut utirunarsivu.
He says that he needs to go heal down south and without his family. And what I liked about this film as a companion, this is called Ce qu'il reste de nous, what is left of us. No, actually, they call it in English, the necessities of life. Yeah, ce qu'il reste de nous is the, if I translate it directly, it says what is left of us. But the actual title they gave it in English is the necessities of life. And it seems like it's almost the same character later on. And he, the actor himself, you appreciate him even more to see him in this setting, in this kind of film, shot on film. Because with Atarnajuat, you forget that they're actors. It's all so real and so authentic that it doesn't look like they're acting at all. Even the, you know, that incredible scene where he's running across the water. I mean, there's a real reality to that. I love to hear that he didn't actually cut himself. He only cut his knee a little bit when he falls down, but that otherwise it's all that is fake blood. Because it's so visceral. When you see it, you believe it.
Monsieur,
also,
je vous présente votre nouveau compagnon. Il s'appelle Tivi. Il est Eskimo, il ne parle pas français. Et je compte sur vous pour lui venir en aide. Venez.
This film is also an interesting film to watch now because he goes through a sort of transformation, the character, into a westernized Inuit. Oh yeah, and the interesting aspect I wanted to share, one of the main reasons is the whole presence of Catholicism in that was prevalent in Canada then, which affected not just Aboriginals and the Inuit and Iroquois and all the First Nations that were here before, but it's also prevalent in our culture. Like it's part of who we were, and because of that, who we are today. Even though religion is really not as present today as it was, like in the 50s, it still has made our. It still marked not just our history, but our view of the world. You know how Catholicism can be with shame being put on different aspects of life. And even though people are not religious to this day, like something people say about Quebec culture, for example, is that in Quebec, whenever someone is successful, like becomes very rich, we look down on that. You know, it's like, oh, out there, oh, he's all big now, you know. This is less so today, but maybe just even 10 years ago, it was something more, or 10, 20 years ago, it was something more common, you know, like Céline Dion or Guy La Liberté of Cirque du Soleil. There was something in that we looked strangely upon. And that might be because of this Catholic heritage. This scene is beautiful. He shows him his sickness, you know, that he has tuberculosis, and throughout the rest of the scene, this actor, this formidable actor, is holding his chest, you know, like he just forgets. And he's seen just now a view inside his body, and it's just touched him so much that the rest of the scene keeps his hand there. I just think it's amazing. This guy is really a great, great actor. So this is by the same director as The Fast Runner. It's called The Searchers, which is also the name of a Western. And I thought the cinematography had been updated wonderfully, you know, the widescreen. They're still using digital technology that's not shot on film, but still you can see how in just 20 years, how much the technology has evolved, and now it's really rivaling the look of film.
Thank you.
Believe it or not, this is actually the trailer to the film. And he just plays this whole scene out. So yeah, the trailer doesn't tell you much about the film, but it's a murder story and they're running away and so on. Seems wonderful. I haven't seen it yet, but I plan on doing that. And I think it's very recent, like from a year or so ago. So that's it for this week. This was Canadian Culture Through Film. And I think now with these two last classes, with the documentary class and now looking at Indigenous film, we've gotten a good view of the North. And now we're going to leave the North for the rest of our classes. And it's sad in a way, but you're going to start feeling warmer from what I'm going to be showing you from now on. Next week, we're looking at animations out of the NFB, of the National Film Board, notably with the films of McLaren, which we're going to have a really good time next week. So thanks again for being with me today. And yeah, I'm gonna see you online through your blog posts and otherwise next Thursday, same bat time, same bat place. Thanks, thanks a lot for being with us this morning, gang. And have a great week.
You as well, enjoy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.